Muy bueno.
Where I'll end up, well, I think only God really knows. I've sat upon the setting sun, but never, 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 never. I never wanted water once, no, never, never, never.
Con la energía cinética producimos
el tema. I let my music take me where my heart wants to go. But never, 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 I'll never make the same mistake.
Victorian style clothing. Now, first thing to point out is that there were two very distinct classes of people. You had your rich people, the ones who had loads of money and not much work to do, and your working classes, who, let's say, they got a little bit scruffier, didn't have as much money, so their clothes showed that. The way of telling them apart is the materials in which the clothes were made of. With the poor people, you had things like cotton and wool, very easily accessible, lots of it around. Then the rich people would be able to splash out on things like silk, and satin, lace, the softer materials, they look a little nicer too. Now I'm going to start with boys. Boys, up until the age of 3, you'd be wearing a dress. Now, that's simply because there were an awful lot of buttons on trousers, so there were no zips or Velcro, nothing like that. And in order to change your nappy, it was simply easier to hoik up a dress than to pull trousers down. So boys would be wearing dresses until about the age of 3. Between the ages of 3 and 10, you'd be wearing shorts. There's less material involved, and if you fall over, scuff your knee up, you're not gonna rip your nice pair of trousers. And trousers came along around the age of 10, when you went into work. So you'd look much more respectable, you're probably not going to be charging around the place, falling over, so you're allowed a pair of trousers. Now, also, once you hit manhood, you'd be wearing trousers and a waistcoat. Vests weren't around at the time, so this was it would go over your shirt to keep you warm in the winter. I'm sure you can probably tell it's quite cold around here, so so the waistcoat is very important. They'd be wearing shirts, of course, button-up shirts with no collar. You might notice on mine, no collar there. Now that's because the collar was detachable. So your neck would get very hot, very sweaty working around, so you'd just be able to pull the collar off, put a clean collar on, and it saves you washing your shirt, so quite ingenious. Yeah. Now, of course, over the waistcoat, you'd be wearing a jacket, one such as this. Looks like a fine example. So this is what you'd be wearing around the town. It's quite nice, and you can even see the cape. So this would have been a rich man's jacket, simply due to the excess material. And you can see here, the silk underneath, it's nice and colourful, it's also very soft. Now you may wonder, why would they have that underneath? It was simply so the rain and elements wouldn't damage the silk. You'd have this outer layer, but whilst you wore it, sling that over your shoulder. In order to show your status, you could afford such fine things underneath. Another example of a man's jacket here. This is once perhaps more working class. It's the material is very different, you'll be able to feel that in just a second. So it's a lot stronger, a lot more durable, and also a lot less fancy, because they couldn't afford to have as many clothes, obviously. Is everyone understanding everything okay so far?
I think so.
Yeah?
Yes?
Are you?
Yes, no problem?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lovely, so to continue on with the gents, you would be expected to wear a hat. Now, if you had money and status, again the rich, you'd be wearing a top hat. The taller the hat, the more money you had, and it wasn't very practical. It didn't serve a purpose as such. It was merely to show that you had, again, a lot of money, so the taller the hat, the more money you had. As you can see from my hat, it's a very big hat, so I am, of course, a very wealthy gentleman. Now that about covers it for the boys. Oh, no, one last thing you may notice here. The cravat, the scarf. Again, this is simply to keep you warm, and if you had a colourful one, you'd be showing your wealth again. So we've got a selection available here. This one's made from silk, so it's quite a nice one. And again, you've got the rougher ones. So it's quite easy to see the two classes based upon what they wore. And now girls. Girls, you've been wearing skirts most of your life. So from the ages of about 3 to 10, you'd be wearing knee-length skirts to give you a lot of freedom of movement, running around to play, etc., etc. Now, as you got a little bit older, the length of your skirt would drop. So, you'd end up wearing one such as this. Very nice calf-length skirt. So this is through your early teens. Now, as you reached womanhood, it was considered very rude to show your ankles. The equivalent today is walking around in your underpants. You probably wouldn't do that. So, to show your ankles was exceptionally rude. So as you got older, so would your skirt. There's one here. That's not a great example. That's still quite short on me. One like that would cover your ankle and thus keep your dignity. Now, women would also wear jackets, but they wouldn't be as fancy as male jackets. Merely a cloak or a cape to wear. Again, for just a little added protection against the rain and the elements. And this is probably a good example of that. So it's not much to it, but it's something else to keep you warm. Now, women would also be wearing hats. A hat such as this, nice and light, would keep your hair out of your face, keep the sun out of your eyes, and it wasn't really that expensive to make. But one such as this. This is quite a rich lady's hat. You can see the veil, the colour again. These are all indications of wealth. So, honestly, I think I've talked for long enough. Who wants to get dressed up? Yeah. Oh, a few. I was expecting more. Well, anyone who'd like to, you're more than welcome to come up and try some clothes on.
Okay, come on, bingo. Come on, girls. Come on now.
Debe de ser.
¿Ah?
Oh my God. Ahora vas ahí abajo con la ropa puesta que dice que ahí abajo para hacer una fotografía. Y os lo hacéis los selfies.
Pero esto es una falda encima, ¿no?
Es un poco complicado, tienes que ponerte algo más. Claro. Esto es para ponerte ahí.
Mira, Tinche, mira, mira qué guapo.
¡Qué barbaridad! Aquí se ve la afición de... tú ya el señor. Toma del brazo, señor. Me tengo que cubrir.
Mira, mira, mira.
¡Olé! ¡Qué belleza!
Yo soy el pobre.
Oh my gosh. El pobre. ¿Y yo y vosotros dos qué pasa? Tienes que apretártelo bien.
Mira, esto.
My life.
wine tonight.
Que se te cae la farda. Que vamos a hacer la foto allí, venga.
Hago yo la foto, hacemos yo el anillo la foto.
And if I ever lose my hands, lose my...
Well, my name's Phil, and I'll be with you for this next and talk and discussion about things. And this one is all about what people's lives were like when they were at home. So the sort of houses they lived in. What we will do is we will look at two different cottages. One was the cottage of one of the richest families here, a family with plenty of money. We'll see that, look at what they had, and then we will look at the cottage of a much, much poorer family, a family with not enough money. And you will see the difference between the rich people's house and the poor people's house. And also some of the differences between life back in Victorian times, so 150 years ago, when Queen Victoria was Queen of England. You will see the difference between life then and life now. So the first cottage we're going to go into, this one just here, Copper Ore Cottage. This was the home of one of the richest families here at Morwell Ham. They had plenty of money. Now we'll go inside. We're going to go into the room which was the kitchen and dining room. Have a look round in there and we'll talk about some of the things which really are missing. Things you would expect to find in a kitchen now. So think about what you see in here and think about your kitchen at home and think what's missing. There is one thing in this room though which wouldn't have been there in Victorian times. Yeah, you spotted the TV. That wouldn't have been there. Okay, so that's just a modern thing. We put a film on to explain some of the history to people. But come on in and have a look around. This thing, if this is the kitchen, what's not here?
The fridge, dishwasher, microwave.
They didn't have any of those things.
But they have oven.
They would have had some things, but those things they didn't have because there was no electricity coming into the house. And of course, for a fridge, for a microwave, for a dishwasher, you need to have electricity. And with no electricity, you can't have any of those things. So yeah, nothing electrical in here at all. Apart from the television, ignore that. So yeah, no fridge, nothing electrical. That's something that's missing. What else would you expect to find in a kitchen that's not in here? So,
microwave.
Nothing electrical, but lose my land. Oh, if I ever lose my hands, oh, I won't have to work no more. And if I ever lose my eyes, if my colors all run dry,
guess if I ever lose my eyes away, I won't have to cry no more. Yes, I'm being followed by a moon shadow, moon shadow, moon shadow, leaping and hopping on.